Tell us a little bit about your story.
So my book is Project Cain, and Project Cain is about 16-year-old Jeff Jacobson, who finds out he is the clone of the serial killer Jeffrey Dahmer, and that his father and other scientists created multiple clones from Jeffrey Dahmer and other serial killers. As he finds out this information that his father has given him because he wants to set him free from Macy, which is the institute, and DSTI, which are the scientists, he gets taken under the wing of this man named Castillo. Castillo is a veteran, an army personnel, who was sent in to find all the research that his father did on the clones of the serial killers. Castillo wasn't told that Jeff was going to be there, so he kind of took him under his wing, and he thought he could help him track down these six boys who were clones of serial killers that went on a killing rampage and were now traveling up America. So the book is mainly Castillo and Jeff in hotel rooms trying to figure out where they're going, what they're doing, and it's also Jeff grappling with the mental illness of seeing Jeffrey Dahmer's victims and this woman in black, who will come up a lot more in the story. She's a very prominent character. She's his father's demon, mental demon, I guess you could say, as he believes he is a descendant of Jack the Ripper. So he talks about this woman in the bed in his journals a lot, so Jeffrey's really dealing with the fact that this isn't his demon, but he sees her everywhere. So yeah, they go up, they find their serial killers, and they learn there is this biological weapon that turns people like into killing monsters, rampaging, and that these teens are planning on releasing it. So they are fighting with them. Eventually they find the boys, but they were killed by this thing in black, and they don't know what it is. It's attacking them. Sometimes Jeff can like feel it and see what it sees. Later they find out that this thing in black is a mix of all the serial killers that they tested. He's 100% killer, and he can hear and feel who could become a possible killer. So they fight these five things in black at this large compound that Castillo and his friend Ox own. And eventually they win, and they go to Macy Institute, which is where the whole thing started, to take down the scientists that are creating these clones. And as it turns out, they have the biological weapon, which Castillo opens in a room full of them in order to save Jeff and all of his friends. And at the end of the story, Jeff and Castillo make it out okay. Castillo's very beaten up, close to death, but he's fine, and they go back to the compound with all of the serial killer clones that they rescued from the institute, and they kind of live out their lives. So yeah, that's Project Cain in very little detail, but it's a very good book. It's got some very deep meanings, and I'm excited to tell you more about it.
What are some of the chief characteristics of the character? How does the main character interact with other characters?
So what are the chief personality traits of the characters? I'm going to be talking about two of the main characters, Jeff and Castillo. They're very different people, but they are the two focuses of the book. So Jeff is very internalized. He says a little bit, he's pretty quippy, he's very in shell-shocked state, but yeah, he's very quippy, he's very thorough, he thinks a lot, he overanalyzes everything. He's also battling with mental health. He's seeing visions of Jeffrey Dahmer's past killer, like, victims, and he's seeing this, like, woman in black everywhere. These are definitely some signs of mental illness. So he's also going through drastic changes. The man who he thought was his father for 16 years was a man who created him in a lab. He had to dye his hair because he's on the run from scientists. So yeah, his characteristics are very understandable for someone who's going on the run. He's very controlled, surprisingly. He doesn't really break down a lot. He's also very smart. He researched. His dad was a scientist, so he's very, very driven. And he's just shocked at some of the things that people could do. And he's also battling with becoming the serial killer. I think he wants to break away from that stereotype that that's what he was made to do. So he's definitely trying to separate himself from that. The other person I'm going to be talking about, is Castillo. Castillo is a war veteran. He's very hard to read, because this book is a journal from Jeff's perspective after the fact. So this is him recounting what happened. So he might miss some things, but Castillo is very hard. He doesn't show a lot of emotion. He's ready to fight, ready to be there. As we learn through the story, he's a hard guy. He doesn't show much. He needs to be the rock for a lot of people and for himself. Another thing we learn about him is he has PTSD. We learn about that through the nightmares that he has, and he's trying to figure out, and he's also really battling with who he's hired by, which is the scientist that made Jeff, what they're doing to these kids, which they are, they're kids. They do have this killer DNA, but they are still children. He's really struggling with his moral compass on whether it's okay to harm them or not. So, yeah, these characteristics, the hard moral dilemmas, their mannerisms, just how Jeff is very kind of secluded because he's been left alone. He's been left by his father and Castillo, who's seen a lot of terrible things. They definitely bring the best out in each other. And yeah, they kind of grow throughout the book. They come together, they open up a bit more, you learn a bit more about their feelings. So yeah. So I kind of touched a little bit on how Jeff interacts with Castillo. They're very solemn towards each other. Castillo doesn't really know what to think of Jeff. He's what he's hunting, basically, so he doesn't really know to begin with how to handle Jeff. Jeff interacts with his father. We don't see much of that because his dad is only in the beginning and then he gets killed later on. But he seems to be very attached. He didn't have a mother. Well, he did, but she wasn't in the picture. So he's very attached to his father, and you can kind of see that throughout the book as he's trying to reach out to him and ask him what's going on. Jeff interacts with the other clones in a kind of curious but scared way. The clones that he interacts with are mostly the clones that have started killing people. So he's curious to the fact that they have the same like kind of DNA, especially when he meets the other Jeffrey Dahmer clone. But he's also curious as the fact that he might become one of them. Like, he's very scared but also curious of that. So he kind of interacts with them in a very interesting way. The other fact is when he does interact with them, they are torturing him, so that's not as fun. But he doesn't want to give a lot away to them because he wants to make sure the good guys win, which definitely separates him from the others. But yeah, it's mostly just Jeff and Castillo interacting. They're very hard towards each other. They don't really understand why the other's doing what they're doing. The only other thing I can think of is Castillo interacting with Ox, who is another veteran who helps them later on in the book. And they're very reminiscent, but Castillo's also a military professional, so he's very straight. He's very professional when he's interacting with other people. He doesn't give a lot of way in the sense of what he's feeling, what he's going through. He has a job to do and he's going to do it.
What is the main character's attitude towards his or her life?
So talking about the main character, which is Jeff, and his attitude towards life, In the beginning, he's very happy with his life. His dad's a scientist. He's proud of that. He gets homeschooled. He has a good life. He's very content. And then his world kind of gets flipped upside down. And so I think he's confused and scared on why this happened to him. Like, why did he have to be a clone? His attitude, you can't really tell, because one, he's a teenage boy, and two, he is struggling with so many other things, like the mental illness, dealing with Castillo. You don't really get a sense of what he's feeling about his life. Like, he's very scared and confused, and he just doesn't want to succumb to what he was supposed to be. He doesn't want to be a killer, he just wants to live his life. So I think he's really struggling with that. And he's just, he's upset with his life, upset on why he was created up until the last chapter, when they take down the scientists and they live on a open ranch, at the end. He's content. He knows, that being a clone is a part of his life, but he knows how to fight it, and he knows how to accept who he is. So yeah, I think that's kind of what he feels like with his life throughout the book, but I think at the end he turns out okay.
What sort of conflict is the character facing?
His biggest conflict is with himself, grappling with the fact that he is a clone of a serial killer. Grappling with the fact that he was meant to be this killing machine to prove the fact that no matter how you grew up, he was supposed to kill people. He was supposed to hurt people. And he's really grappling with the fact that that's not what he wants to do, but he's scared that it's going to happen just because that's what he was made to do and it's in his DNA. That's one of the main problems he's grappling with. He's also grappling with his mental health. Seeing this woman in black that I mentioned before, and the victims of Jeffrey Dahmer have really taken a toll on him, and understanding that it wasn't him doing that, and that he is not guilty for that, that he is his own person, and that the woman in black is his father's demon. Not his. His father created this for him. His father also believes that he is a descendant of Jack the Ripper. And he talked about seeing this woman in black before Jeff was created. So he's grappling with the fact that not everything he can control. He can't control everything. He's also dealing with chasing down these kids that are the same as him and that he grew up with and they met at the institute where they studied the clones, that they are one of him and that he's hunting them and they're doing such terrible things. He's really, his biggest conflict is really fighting that nature versus nurture type thing, that it's not in his blood. He has the choice to decide his life.
At the end of the story, is the main character different from how she was at the beginning of the story?
So talking both with Jeff and Castillo, how they were different, Castillo definitely opens up more. He understands that some of the things that he did was wrong, but it was his job, and he kind of accepts that, and he sacrifices himself to save Jeff. He doesn't end up dying, but Jeff changed a lot. He, again, is deciding that it's not what he wants to do. He doesn't want to hurt people. And he's definitely come out of his shell a lot more. He's more independent, more strong than before, because of all of this that he went through.
What is the setting of the work? How does the setting affect the characters in the story? Does the setting simply provide a backdrop, or is it symbolic?
Setting. Setting plays a big role in the story, not in the fact that it's very big and bold and big, beautiful landscapes. It's really the fact that it's small. As Jeff is dealing with his mental illness, he's trapped in a very small hotel room with a big, burly man. And he doesn't really have anywhere to go. He's really on the run. So this really symbolizes how trapped he is in his own mind and how he's struggling with the fact that he's trapped in his DNA and what he is supposed to be. It also symbolizes how he's dealing with his mental health. He's kind of pushing it away and making it a lot smaller. Every time he sees the faces, he averts his eyes, and eventually it kind of blows up in his face and kind of comes out, and he can't really stop it, which is kind of what happens in the battle at the compound. It's this big 8-acre compound, and it's kind of a representation of Jeff moving from this very small, cramped space and trying to live to this huge open battle. So it's kind of a representation of his mental health. And yeah, it's taking place in the US, which is where a lot of books are taking place, I guess. Setting isn't really a big thing in this book other than the hotel room, where they spend a large majority of the book. Another big part is part of the clues that Jeffrey's dad has left after he set him free was different little symbols and words which symbolize different towns where clones are. So that's really all that setting is. It symbolizes quite a lot for Jeff. But
what major world events were taking place during the author's time of writing this novel that would have impacted the novel itself?
I have a little bit of research here about Geoffrey Giard. He was born in Germany in 1967. He's the author of historical thrillers and dark speculative fiction. He's currently a teacher. There really wasn't a lot about him. It was a lot about his works. But I can tell you kind of what happened after his birth. After his birth in 1967, well, it's still happening, but it became a lot more apparent to the public. Chemical and mostly biological warfare began to pick up, and it was told to the world by the United States government about all these terrible things that they did in the past, like the Tuskegee experiment, Project F, and a lot more. Biological warfare was definitely a big part of the US in the 1900s up until the 2000s, all through that century. It really became apparent that biological warfare was going to be a thing, especially biological and chemical warfare. The rise of serial killers also happened. Jeffrey Dahmer, John Wayne Gacy, Albert Fisher, Ted Bundy, they all kind of came either a little bit before or after that, which is a big part of the book, clearly. So it was really just kind of a dark time. They had all these terrible things like fluoride, which is poisonous, but it is in our because it makes our teeth white, it's in our water and in our toothpaste, which is crazy. And like the Tuskegee experiment, giving people syphilis. It was really a dark time, and especially if you focus on historical thrillers and dark speculative fiction, it would really influence your writing and how you talked about things, especially serial killers. Like, I'm very fascinated by them, but it's a very dark topic, especially with Jeffrey Dahmer. He killed so many and decapitated, and necrophilia, and it was just such a dark time, and especially researching stuff for this book would really affect you and affect your writing style, how dark this is, and especially writing from a 16-year-old's perspective and how he's handling this. So, Jeffrey Girard's life and what happened during it definitely affected the book. It made it a lot darker, and yeah.
Does the story have a theme? Does the theme offer a new insight into human experiences, or does it support the old, traditional one?
The theme of the story, I can already see it in your head. Caitlin, how are you going to write this for your ISU? Your theme is serial killers. It's pretty straightforward. But the theme is very implicitly stated. You really have to dig deep to find out what it is. So the theme that I found through reading the story is you can be made, and it can be in your DNA to be something, but it's who you want to be that is who you are. The way you treat people, the way you act, is a driving force in your life, and it doesn't matter if you were made to be a serial killer, or if you were conditioned to spread hate, or if you were conditioned to be a gang member, or anything like that. It's who you want to be and how you treat people and how you feel about yourself that really is who you are. And talking about social problems, if it's traditional or a new take, it's definitely a new take to the same message. It's a very traditional message. It's how you act is who you are, but it takes it to a whole new level. It takes it to a biological level, even though he is designed to be a serial killer and he's designed to hurt people. He chooses to be kind and to never hurt someone. He chooses to be above that. So it's a very complex question, but it's a traditional stance, but a new take on it.
What lesson or message does the author want the reader to understand from the story?
It's really going with the theme. What does the author want the reader to understand about the story? It's really, you are who you want to be. It doesn't matter your DNA, how you were raised, what your parents wanted you to be, what a group of scientists wanted you to be. As long as you know who you want to be, you can achieve it. It doesn't matter any of the circumstances. You are your own individual, and you can rise above all the boundaries and the barriers set against you, and you can be a good person. Thank you so much for the interview.